students and welcome to the lecture. In today's class, we will see design of cold storage rooms. Cold storages are used for storing the perishables for longer durations. Generally, cold storage are used for agriculture produce which are stored in bulk. So, cold storage design is important aspect for our economy and as well as for agriculture. So, in today's class we will design a cold storage room with the respect of water, with the respect of heat load calculations and cooling load calculations. So, let's start the lecture. So, we will find out the cooling load in cold storage room. First, what is cold storage? Cold storage is a room in which we can place our produce or agriculture produce to increase their shelf life, because keeping the produce in a cold room will increase the shelf life of the product, because it will decrease the metabolism rate of microorganism, it will decrease the rate of deterioration of the product. That's why it will extend the shelf life. Hence, the cold storage rooms are important in agriculture. So, what is a cold room? Cold room is used to store perishable goods. Cold room is stored for use of perishable goods such as meats and vegetables to slow down their deterioration and preserve them as a fresh as possible as long. So, heating accelerator their deterioration is so the product are cooled down by removing the heat. Okay. So, heating called deterioration, and by removing the heat will slow down the deterioration. To remove the heat we use refrigeration system. So, with the help of we have to develop a refrigeration system, with that we will remove the heat, and this allows to accurate and automatically control of the temperature and to preserve the good for longer time. So, and refrigeration system is a system which enables us to keep check on temperature, and we can maintain a low temperature for longer durations. So, there are four components of a refrigeration system. Two components of refrigeration systems are shown in this figure. First is evaporator and another one is condenser. A part of these two systems, there are another two systems, expansion valve and compressor, which is not shown here. So, what happens from evaporator is nothing but a cold storage room, in which evaporator maintains the temperature, and condenser will again recirculate the refrigerant to the evaporator to maintain the temperature over there. Okay, this is the cycle. This we have seen earlier also in freeze dryers and all those things. So, refrigeration unit is not, with the help of refrigeration unit we'll fix evaporator as a cold storage room, and we will try to maintain the low temperature over there. This is the gist. So, when we are designing a cold storage room, we have to go for the heat load or cooling load calculations. So, we will solve this with a problem. We will see this topic with a problem. So, as a problem we have to design a cold storage room with a dimension of 6 into 5 into 4 meters. Let this will be the dimension of cold storage room. And then ambient air is at 30 degrees Celsius and 50% RH. So, outside temperature is 30 degrees Celsius and 50% RH humidity, whereas inside temperature we have maintained 1 degree Celsius and 95% RH. Inside we are having 1 degree Celsius temperature and 95
percent RH.
This is what we are keeping inside. So after that, the walls, the roof and the floor are insulated with 80 mm of polyurethane with a U valve of with a U value of 2.87. So everything is insulated with a material known as polyurethane with a U value of 0.28 watt per meter square, watt per meter square Kelvin, and 80 mm insulation. Part of this, they asked us to store 4,000 kgs of apple of new apple arriving each day at a cold storage room. Okay, each day they are dealing with 4,000 kgs of apple, and the temperature of 5 degrees Celsius is the temperature of apples when they are arriving to the cold storage, and 3.65 kilojoule per kg degree Celsius is the specific heat. These things they have given us in the numerical. We have to design a cold storage room of dimension 4 into 6 into 5 meters with the temperature, outside temperature of 30 degrees Celsius and RH of 50%. Inside temperature is 1 degree Celsius and RH of 95 degrees Celsius. We have to store the apple of 4,000 kgs a day. So at least we will plan to store an apple for 4 days, 5 days. Okay. So we won't expect that each day the apples will come and somebody will buy it. So we have to provide a cushion of 4 days. So like each day this much apple is coming inside each day. So we will plan for 3-4 days, we will see this later how many days we are going to design for. At the inlet temperature of the produce is at the time when the apples are arriving, the temperature was 5 degrees Celsius with specific heat of 3.65 kilojoule per kg degree Celsius. And this whole room is insulated from the even the floor, side wall, everything with 80 mm thickness of polyurethane. So this is the question. Now they ask us to design a cold storage room for this. So before designing anything, we should have this much, like before designing a cold storage room, we should have this much information so that we can design it properly. Still many information are missing, but we will see them, what is missing and what we can include further, okay. So this will be our cold storage room, okay. So there are different types of load, heating load or cooling load we can say. So first one is transmission load, okay. So first of all we have to design the cold storage for the transmission load, which is generally like suppose out of 100% transmission load is around 5 to 15% of total load. So from where transmission load occurs? Transmission load occurs because of walls, all sides of walls, from the roof and from the floor. So these are the resultant of the transmission load, okay. Transmission load means from the surrounding to the system, how much load is or heat is lost by the system from the surrounding to the system, okay. So how much load is there, so that we have to calculate. So heat always flows from the hot and cold. We know that inside cold is there, outside hot is there, that's why this load is occurring. The interior of room is cold and lower temperature than it surrounds, so the heat is always trying to enter, okay. Higher if exposed to the direct sunlight this transmission load is much higher if the room is directly facing to the sunlight, or direct sunlight is falling on the room, then transmission load will be high. So generally we put cold storage room inside a big halls or ACs, okay, with halls or in sheds only we keep the cold storage room, so that we can reduce the transmission load. Okay, so from all completely or from the 100% of cooling load, our transmission load is 5 to 15%. Coming to next slide comes how to calculate the transmission load. So transmission load can be calculated by using this formula, Q is equals to U A delta T into 24 by 10,000. Okay, so Q in kilowatt hour per day. So we are going to find for one day. Okay, so whatever unit is, we are going to convert into one day. So Q will be the kilowatt hour per day heat load, how much load we are getting. Then U will be the value of insulation in watt per meter square, the conductivity of insulation in the watt per meter square Kelvin, which is given to us. A will be the surface area of the walls. So surface area of walls and roofs and floor we have to find out. We have to calculate this. Then T, temperature, inside temperature and outside temperature, inside the room and outside the room, is given to us. And 24 is for 24 hours in a day, because this will give you in 1 hour. So we have to multiply it for 24. And 1000 is the conversion of watt to kilowatt. So this is formula we are going to use. So let's see the formula. First we have to find out the area. So we know we are having a cube. Our room is a cubicle, right? So we are having a cube of 6 meter, 4 meter and the 5 meter. This will be 5, this will be 6, this will be 4. So how many sides this room is having? So this room is having one side, two side. One will be behind it, one will be here. So this room is having 4 sides because of walls, one roof, 4 walls, correct, one roof and one floor. These are the areas from which the air, the heat will try to get into the system. So we will calculate the area for all the units. Okay, so let us consider first this wall. So what will be the area for this wall? 6 into 4 meter, that will be 24 meter, correct. The opposite wall of this is also having same dimension, right? So that is also same. Now let's calculate this wall area. So let's calculate this wall area, how much we are getting for this. So this is 5 meter, this is 4 meter, 4 into 6 equals 20. So this wall and this wall are having same area, again 20. So which one is remaining now? Now roof and floor is remaining. So this is 5, this is 6, correct. For roof and floor they are remaining, so here this is roof and floor. So 6 into 5 or 5 into 6 will give you 30, same for roof and same for floor. So this will be the area for all sides of our room we are going to design. Then this area we are going to use in calculation. For that we have to calculate the overall complete area from where the heat is transferring. So now our formula was Q is equals to UA delta T, correct, into 24 divided by 1000, correct. This was the formula we have seen. So area we have find out already. What is the total area? Like 224 was there, 20 was there, 30 was there. Complete area came as 113 meter square. Area we got it here. U was given in numerical, which is 0.28 watt per meter square. in outlet temperature was given 30 degree Celsius, inlet temperature was given 1 degree Celsius. Correct? 24 and 1000 was given. So transmission load due to the walls was 22 kilowatts a day. Correct? Now the transmission load from the floor we have to see. This is from roof and from the wall. Okay. So now we have to see how much from the floor we are getting, because the temperature of floor is different from temperature of roof and walls, right? So generally the floors will be colder. Okay, the floors will be cooler. So there is another transmission load from the floor also, which again we will use same formula, Q is equals to V I delta T. Correct. Area, we know already how much area we are having. U is given, insulation material. So temperature of the product, the temperature of outside, like ground temperature, we have considered 10 degrees Celsius, which was not given, we have considered, because generally the ground was cooler than the air, correct. So ground temperature we have considered 10 degrees Celsius, and inside temperature is again 1 degree Celsius. How much floor load we are having? 1.5 kilowatt per day. So if the floor was not insulated, then we have to use different formulas, okay. And the total transmission load, what is that? 23 kilowatts, okay, we have to add both the loads, this 2 and this 1, we have to add both. So total loads was 23.8 kilowatt hour per day. This was the total load, total transmission load. Okay, but remember one thing, that if the room is in direct sunlight, then we have to take other factors also, okay, sun factors also, then we have to multiply this load with the other factors, okay, like factor of 2 or 3, depending upon the sunlight we are getting. So after calculating the transmission load, next come the cooling load calculation. So this cooling load is basically the major part of the work, cooling load, like load calculation in our problems, because this consists about 55 to 75% of this total load. Okay, so this is major part of the our problem. Okay, so cooling load will be the energy which we are generally supplying to our produce, so that the temperature of the produce can be brought down. So that is the cooling load. Okay. So product exchange the heat in cooling load, cooling or freezing of the product and packaging will occurs in cooling load only, and product respiration rate also we have to consider when we are calculating the cooling load of product. Okay, we have seen the transmission load was just 5 to 15%, whereas cooling load is 55 to 75% of the total load. So this cooling load can be of two type, okay. So first one will be a sensible heat calculation will be there, like the heat which we can sense, okay. So like which is above the freezing temperature of the of our produce. So in our problem we are not freezing the produce, correct. We are only taking it up to just 1 degree Celsius, correct. In case, if suppose our temperature was maintaining temperature was minus 4 degree Celsius or minus 5 degree Celsius, in that time we have to take consideration latent heat also, okay, latent heat of freezing, okay, that we have to take in consideration. But here today we are dealing only with the sensible heat, so we won't worry about that. But if freezing, then calculate sensible plus latent heat phase change occur, okay. If we are freezing, then we have to calculate the sensible plus the latent heat also. This is point to remember. So how to find out the product load? First is product exchange, how much load, how much cooling load or how much energy product is exchanging, okay. So suppose we have storing the apple, we know already what how much apple we are storing, 4000 kgs of apple we are storing, and the apple inlet temperature is 5 degrees Celsius and specific heat is given this. The formula we are using is Q is equals to mcp delta T divided by 3600. Okay. So delta T is the temperature entering and temperature of the store. Temperature of the store is 1 degree Celsius, temperature entering is the 5 degree Celsius. So let's see here, the formula is this. Q we have to find out for a day. So sensible heat we got for, kilojoule per kg degree Celsius, right? So this we have to convert into, R. Okay, for that we have multiplied it with kilojoule to kilowatt hour, we have to multiply it with 3600. Okay, M will be the mass of the product, Cp will be a specific heat, temperature difference will be the delta T, and M, Cp delta T, we will put here M will be 4000, Cp will be 3.65, we know 5 degrees Celsius is the temperature of the apple outside and 1 degree Celsius will be temperature of the apple inside the store or store temperature. So total heat load we are getting is 16 kilowatt per day. This much is the heat load for cooling 4000 kgs of apple and bring down the temperature to 1 degree Celsius. But this is not it. We have to find out the respiration rate also, okay, respiration, heat generation due to respiration. Because when produce respire, they generate the heat. How much heat we are getting? So, we let us use that 1.9 kg of kilojoule per kg per day of the heat is produced, or rate of heat is produced by the apples, okay, and we are dealing with 20,000 kgs of apple. Now we said that we are getting 4,000 apples per day. Now we know that we can't sell each day we can't sell apples, right? So we have to design our cold storage for certain number of days. So we are going to store 5 days these apples for 4,000 kgs per day. So total our storage capacity will be 20,000. Okay, kgs is our total storage capacity. We should have this much storage capacity so that we can store 20,000 apples. Okay, this is a thumb rule. Like if somebody will ask you to design a cold storage for 10,000 kgs of their produce, we know that time will come when he has to deal with 5 times of that capacity. Okay, so we are going to see, we are going to design 5 times of the capacity which is desired. So this is the respiration rate heat generated from the cold storage. So the formula is Q is equals to mass into respiration by 3600. This is again multiply, convert this joule into kilowatt hour. And RSP is the respiration rate heat produced, which we know already 1.96. And what is the mass? We know 20,000. 1.96 into 3600, which is equal to, we are getting 10.5 kgs per day. This is the heat generated due to respiration of the produce, which is 10.5 kgs per day. Okay. Now we will calculate the cooling load. How much means load calculations for internal loads, okay. So there are some internal loads, like we are having lights, we are having human beings which are roaming inside the cold storage, okay. So what will be that heat generated by them which we have to overcome so that the temperature can be maintained, okay. So internal heat load, which is generally of 10 to 20% of total load. Again, this is a big number, 10 to 20% of the total load. So here we are going to consider load by people, lights and equipment, machine if they are running. So as we know that lights, machines, equipments when they are running, or a human being when they are working, they release some heat, body heat, right? So that we have to find out how much body heat we are going to consider. So we have seen the transmission load, we have seen the product load, now we are seeing the internal load. So coming to this, so what is internal load? because of people. So we estimate how many people will be working inside a room at a particular given time, that we will estimate. So let us consider that there are two people are working at the present time, there are two people are working in a construction for 4 hours a day, right? So generally nobody will stay longer than 30 minutes or 14 minutes in a cold storage room because temperature was so low. So let us consider two people will be there for at least for 4 hours in a day inside a cold storage room. And we see at this temperature they will give around 270 watts of heat per hour. Okay, this is the body heat released by the human beings per hour at that temperature. So how much heat load we have to cool, how much heat load we are dealing with because of human interference. So that is equals to, Q is equals to number of people into time into heat divided by 1000. So again, Q will be in kilowatt hour per day. How people will be, how many people we are, number of people we are dealing with, time will be length of time they are spending inside the cold storage room. In our case, that is 4 hours. And the heat loss in watt we have seen, how much heat they are generating, that is 270 watts. And then converting these watts into kilowatts, we have to divide it by 1000. So our calculation will be 270 divided by 1000, which is equals to 2.16 kilowatt per day. So this is about internal heat because of human being. Now there will be some lights inside the cold storage, right? So we can't work in dark, so we need to put some lights, and light generate lot of heat. How much heat? So the formula for that we use, number of lamps, time will be the working time of one light, okay, how much time light is switched on, and what is the wattage of the light, okay, how much watt power the light is having, divided by 1000 to this 1000 is to convert this watt into kilowatt. So lamps will be a number of lamps, time, hours per day, how much time we are running, wattage will be the power rating of the lamp bulb or the lamp we are using, 1000 to convert watt into kilowatt. So let us assume we are using 3 lamps of 100 watts each, which is running for at least for 4 hours in a day, because whenever a human entering inside a chamber, they have to switch on the light to see. So let us assume they need to switch on 3 lights, and they are working for 4 hours, and the capacity of each bulb is 100 watt. So total load we are dealing now is 3 into 4 hours into 100 watt divided by 1000, which is equals to 1.2 kilowatt hour per day. So we know how much heat we are generating because of lights. And now we'll find out total internal load. Okay, we sum both the loads, which is load because of people and load because of lights, and then we will get 3.36 kilowatt hours per day. This is the input load, okay, internal load because of people and lights. So next, after this, we are having equipment loads. So in a cold storage, there are not only lights, people, there are some equipments also placed, okay. Even the condenser or evaporator parts which are there, even the fans which are there, if they are working, they generate some heat. Okay, so we have to consider that also, that heat also, because it is again 1 to 10% of the total load. Okay, we can't neglect 10% of something. So we have to consider the equipment load also. So here generally comes the evaporator fans or evaporator defrost cycles. Generally comes the fans or defrost cycles, okay, either fans or forest defrost cycle. From there we will generally heat them and defrost our areas, okay, so that is helping. So fan motors give off the heat when in use, evaporator need deforest. So evaporators need deforesting, and fans are generating heat whenever they are working. So how to calculate the fan load or motor load? So which is equals to number of fans into how much time they are running into what is the wattage of one fan divided by 1000. Simple, same as bulbs. Then we'll get kilowatt per hour, fans, number of fans we'll put, time in hours we'll put, wattage is the capacity or the power rate of that fan or something. Okay, and 1000 will be to convert watt into kilowatt. So if suppose we are having a three fans, okay, of 200 watts and running for 14 hours per day, because we have to cool the room, right? So running for 14 hours per day, then we are getting 8.4 kilowatts per hour by 3 into 14 hours, 3 fans for 14 hours of capacity of 200 watt for, this is for converting watt to kilowatt. After fan load, then comes the fan motors. So motor and fan are two separate things which we have to consider here, because motor itself generates some heat, okay. So that will be equals to power into time into cycles into efficiency. So power rating of the motor, whatever, like in kilowatt, how many, 780,000 kilowatt, what will be the power rating of the motor, that will be power. Time will be the deforesting time, for deforesting how much time we have to run the motor for, correct, in hours. The cycles, how many times in a day we have to deforest the cycling load, because deforesting will occur whenever our temperature is very low and moisture RH is very high. Forest, the freezing of water vapors inside the rooms will occur, and then we have to defrost it, okay, by running some motors. That's why defrosting is needed. And how many times we are doing this? Lower the temperature, more the cycle of deforesting, correct. So how much time of deforestation, how many cycles of deforesting is, that will become such a cycle, and what is the efficiency of deforesting or transferring of the heat into space. So for that, let us consider we are using electric heater element for deforesting with the capacity of 1.2 kilowatt and it runs for 30 minutes for 3 times in a day, and its efficiency is 30% of all the energy consuming just transferred. Whatever it is consuming, it is just giving 30% of that, okay. So we will get, that is the power of the motor or the pump we are going to use for deforesting for half an hour in a day, 3 times in a day with the efficiency of 0.3, like 30% efficiency. So we are getting 0.54 kilowatt hour per day. This will be the deforesting equipment power consumption or heat cooling load consumption. So what is the total cooling load? We have find out the fan heat load and the deforest heat load. Correct. We have to add both. The answer we got, 0.94 kilowatt hour per day is the total equipment load we are dealing with. So next come infiltration load. So this will be the last. So infiltration load is because of the, whenever we are opening the room of the cold chamber, heat will get inside, okay, because they also having tendency to go from the higher temperature to a lower temperature, correct. So inside temperature will be lower, so hot air will replace the cold air as fast as possible. So as soon as we are opening the door, we are having some heat loss. Okay, how to calculate heat loss? So this heat loss is either can be for doors, air ventilation, or other types of ventilation, like there will be a ventilator shaft or there will be a window. So from that also air can come in. So we have to find out infiltration load. So calculation of infiltration load is depending upon the volume of air getting inside the system. Okay, so suppose how much volume of air is replaced every time we are opening the door, that is V. Changes means how many times we are opening the door or how many times we are giving the chances to air to shift their paths. Okay, that will be the changes. how much energy? Energy per cubic meter per degree Celsius is the energy, how much energy we are dealing with for each cycle. Delta T, what is the temperature difference? We know already what is the temperature difference around inside and outside. Okay, and this is to convert kilojoule into kilowatt hour. So we are, suppose we are having 5 volume of air changes per day, like 5 times we are at least opening the door per day. Okay, so due to the door being open, the volume is calculated to be 120 meter cube, and each cubic meter of new air provides how much? This much load they add. Okay, for each cubic meter we are having 2 kilojoule per degree Celsius, and the inlet outside temperature is 30 degrees Celsius, inlet temperature is 1 degree Celsius. So this 5 times in a day we are opening the doors, each time we are replacing this much volume of air, and the heat which is lost is 2 kgs per degree Celsius per volume of the air. So answer we are getting is 9.67 kilowatt hours per day. 30 and 1 is the temperature difference, 3600 is the conversion factor. So now we will calculate the total cooling load, how much total cooling we are performing inside a cold storage. So we have seen transmission load was this much, product load which is because of the apple's respiration rate, correct, and the initial temperature difference, what is the product load. Internal load we have seen because of human being, because of light. Then we have seen equipment load because of fans, motor, deforesters, correct. Then we have seen infiltration load because of air entering inside the chamber, okay, air entering inside the cooling system or cold room. Then we have to add all these things. So total load will be addition of all, which is 72.27 kilowatt hour per day. So this is the total load, which cooling load which we have to deal with. But story haven't finished here. So this is the exact calculation we have done. Okay. But typically this calculation are not that accurate, so we have to provide some extra benefit for these things. So that's why we add 10 to 30% of these values. Okay. We as a factor of safety. Okay. So in our case, let us consider 20% of factor of safety. So we will multiply this value with 1.2 times, like 20% extra. Okay, we will multiply this load factor of safety with 1.25. Now our cooling load is 86.7 kilowatt hour per day. So we know how much we need to cool. Now we will find out the refrigeration cooling capacity of sizing. Okay, so we know that our machine is not going to run for 24 hours, because if it is going to run for 24 hours, then things will be easy. Like our answer will be 86 kilowatt hour per day we have to cool, but our machine 86.7 kilowatt hour per day we have to cool, but we are not going to work for this much time, correct? We are not going to work for this much less time, right? We are going to work for 14 hours in a day. So how much work we are doing per hour? That we have to find out. So we will divide these things up to 14. So our refrigeration capacity per hour will be, heat capacity will be 62.2 kilowatt per hour to sufficiently meet the cooling load. So this much heat, 6.2 kilowatt we have to cool per hour so that we can achieve 86.7 kilowatt hour a day of heating load. Okay, how we find out this? This is equals to total cooling load divided by total working hours. Okay, this is it. for today's lecture. So we have completed cooling load calculation over here. So I hope this lecture will be clear for you, and we will solve further more numericals in classroom on this topic. So this is also a practical lab for you people. Thank you very much.